Hello guys, this is DJ.
This is Marco.
And Michal.
And this is CG Talks, a podcast where CG guys talk about CG.
You are getting better and better with this announcement, like professional radio host.
Yeah. Come on, that's what I'm getting paid for. You know? Sitting the whole day in front of a mirror and practicing, you know, this short line. It's my only line, man. That's how they
say. You had one job.
Yeah.
It's like, I remember when I was like, at college, I met a girl who on a party she would walk around with like this bottle of wine cup in her mouth all the time. I don't know how it's called. It's like this wooden cup. And I asked why she's doing that. She says that she's training her diction, because she wants to be a radio host. And yeah, I forgot about her. And several weeks ago, it was 20 years ago, like for example. And several weeks ago, I discovered she's actually host in a very big Polish radio.
Damn.
She made it. So
we could make that podcast, you know, about, you know, sticking to your goals and achieving, you know, in the long run. But I guess for today we prepared a different topic. Like, does art have rules? So yeah, maybe the first rule should
might
be,
not be so different.
Yeah, you have
rule
to keep,
number one: stick to your guns.
Yeah.
Oh no, not stick to your guns.
Keep consistent.
Yeah, yeah, be consistently. You know, practice consistently. Do whatever it is you need to do. Walk around with that. With that wooden cup in your mouth, metaphorically.
But this is what many artists admit. I mean, not even visual artists, that every very big artist was at least once tempted and executed that idea of pleasuring the audience, just creating something in this thought in mind that there's some fade, you know, like there's something is in fashion right now, or I should do this way because this is what people expect, and that always ended up with a failure. Like every time you are true to yourself, it works out better, even if there's like if there is some friction in the reception of your work. If people would say this is like I don't understand it, or this is like weird, or this is any way, like as long as you are you don't betray yourself with what you do, this is going to work much better, even if this is not like laser precise message. For example, artistic message, it's going to be much better if you are honest to your guts. Right.
But I guess you also have to kind of like be open to the world, because we're not just kind of like internal beings, not, you know, interacting with the world in any way. So like I guess a feedback from the world outside is also important. And I guess it's going to be part of our today's discussion, like what kind of rules we can learn from the world that we experience. Because I think there definitely are rules to art, like some different formulas, but is there the holy grail that everyone is looking for, like the secret perfect render button that you press and get the perfect artwork out of your 3D DCC? Or
so I guess you're talking more about like the rules of sort of the rules to marketing art, the marketing rules of art. Like, I mean, because clearly, like, there are, you know, there are fundamentals that, you know, regardless of what you eventually want to do or want to do, like, they always help, right? And I think things like, like composition or being able to properly measure things, being able to structure things, able to, you know, like, your ability to select color and all of, like, there are established combinations and practices that like as far as making a technically pleasing work of art is concerned, you know, always work. So I mean, those are there are those rules, but then there are also the rules of like you could say that, for example, if you were, if you made woke art today, then that would be like, you, that would probably help you, you know. And I in fact, I remember also watching a video by I forgot who, but he was like some, he, I guess he has a channel dedicated to digital art, and he kind of gives advice to his audience, and he was saying that there are many ways to kind of make it, like to get a lot of attention these days with your art, and some ways are you know, like you can easily adapt and start using, and there are other ways that are a bit, well, maybe not like in his words, like something he wouldn't recommend, but he mentioned like this one artist who made a big name for him or herself by making sort of I guess like some kind of erotic art that's based on kind of based on anime or something along that extent. Like there's a whole movement on like where, you know, like I guess you, I'm sure you've seen like those sort of like voluptuous anime night ladies who are basically wearing steel bikinis. Like I'm sure you've seen like something like that along those lines, where, you know, like it sells, but it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, maybe you really like to do that, but if it's not something you want to do, I mean, that's a very distasteful way to adapt to what people want. I mean, if that's not what you want to do, I mean, not saying that it's, I mean, personally, I find it kind of distasteful, but it might not be the same for everyone. Like people have their reasons for doing that. So, but yeah, you know, it's, I find that like those kind of rules, like, yeah, they're a bit harder to find out. I mean, there are some that are tried and tested, but that doesn't necessarily mean it will work for you, right? And how?
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of like the like social reception of art, like you said, like marketing your art is an interesting thing. I think it's like strictly connected to the whole like rule of making a good artwork in per se, right? Because it's much easier to like really market something that's really like technically done well, like in a sense of composition, color scheme, stuff like that, so that it has impact. Like I've seen a video by some art salesman that said that good, you know, good paintings always have like this immediate impact, that you all almost instantly get some kind of reaction to it, right? So and it can be different, and that might, like what you said, it might not be really like art, in, like artistic or like maybe aesthetic, but also kind of like maybe controversy or whatever. But the funny thing about today's art is that I've seen like a meme showing that today's artist is like super nervous. I haven't posted for a day on my social media account, whatever. And the, you know, the old masters that were working on their masterpieces for like decades, months or years to get to the point of their masterpieces, and not having like such a great volume. Like usually they had a pretty big volume of artworks. Yeah, in fact, yeah. So that might be one way to get like just consistently practice your art, right? Craft and art.
This posting part, it's advertising. So I recently saw a video of Arnold Schwarzenegger giving advice to young people, and he had very simple advice. So one was to have a very clear goal of how your success or achievement, whatever you want to do, is going to look like. So not like I'm going to be great bodybuilder, I'm going to win the Mr. Universe, right, in 2 years, let's say. It can work out or not, but this is very clear and just focuses your all resources. But the other stuff which he said, and I don't think I ever heard it from people giving advice about achieving anything, was that, and now when you do it, you should advertise it. This is very important. Like, let's say you are an artist, I don't know, whatever art you do, advertise it so people know what you do, and this is going to, you will get some reactions to that, and some good stuff is going to come back from the universe, like from other people, like, you know, an offer of cooperation, stuff like that. So this Instagram stuff for me sounds like this anxiety, sounds like somebody's paying too much attention to the advertising. And I think that, you know, it's like to get some good stuff from the environment, you have to have like good product or whatever, like good art, good content, and however you call it, and then you need to advertise it. But you actually maybe go into a false impression that the reactions of your, of let's say the Instagram followers, are what's important, and this regular posting is so important because and without it you are losing something. But because I think the advertising itself can create some kind of reaction, even though you are not really like progressing in your work. I mean really stuff like Instagram, there's a huge algorithms. This is a huge technical invention which is working exactly to get you as much attention as you can, so you can have a illusion that this attention, I mean, by making all these movements on Instagram, posting, you are getting attention. This is what you need, but when actually this is not created by what you do, this is to some, at least in a short, very short term, like hyped up by this media, advertising media, which Instagram is. So if people are anxious about it, then this is like almost a psychological issue, because it's like, are you really what are you afraid of? Are you afraid that nobody will hear about you or know what you do, or you will miss some opportunity? You already have, let's say, some established some kind of your place among other artists, and you have people who, I don't know, there are people who like what you do, but is it like some kind of codependence, like chasing like this good feeling that people say, yeah, this is awesome? Like, it's a very short term, and I think that many very good artists, like they are long-term runners. I mean, you can be in oblivion for years and finally emerge if you really know where you are going with what you do, and you are not, what's the point of having several thousands likes on February 2020 when there's another guy who doesn't have that because he's not really chasing that so much, but in 5 years this guy is going to, you know, you are going to ask him questions how to do better art in 5 years, because he's like, I like, one of my favorite artists is David Lynch, and I remember that his first movie didn't even qualify to any festival. It was Eraserhead, and it was a crazy movie, but it was completely crazy movie, but it was also, I mean, for the sake of originality, it should qualify, because it was something that was never there before. So he said that he was, you know, kind of like, he knew that this is a very good movie. I mean, whatever good movie is in terms, I mean, like, this movie is weird, but it's at least interesting to see. And he was very discouraged. So he said, okay, so I am not a really filmmaker player, that even they don't know to watch my movie, like in the final competition, like there are like 200 movies and they don't even want to see it. And yeah, he just kept doing his stuff, and he finally, you know, he was one of the best directors of, I don't know, 90s. So yeah, so this Instagram, I think this is less about art, this is more about being
perseverance.
This is more about no, just like you are too dependent on this dopamine rush when you get some reactions.
Yeah,
like you are like cigarettes, I think. So, by the way, we were supposed to talk about the rules in art, and we kind of drifted towards marketing.
But, or maybe not just like marketing, but generally like being an artist and following your own path. I guess that's how you can.
That works out. I mean, like I can say that I'm not a great artist. I'm not a known artist. Whatever. I just do this because I like some stuff to do. But there are artists that I like a lot. For example, in Poland, there were some artists. Like I don't remember her name. There's a female artist who draws very disturbing images. They're like some kind of nightmares of people. I mean, I will check this name later, and maybe next week I will mention it. And yes, she's a very good example of she knows what she's doing. She addresses some kind of area of feelings, which people have like this. Her works, it's like there is recently that cringe alert stuff around. So she should have like huge cringe alert before you watch it. And I noticed that she gets a lot of, you know, like she was dismissed at first, or people like criticize it, like everybody can draw such a thing, you are not a very good artist. But that was that core, very deep, that little core that was hers. And she was addressing that in these works, and she's doing that all the time. And of course, after some time, like the society, the publicity, I mean, people couldn't resist admitting, couldn't, you know, not admit that there is something very good at, very important at these works. Like, finally, it crashes all the bullshit arguments that people were trying to use against her. On the other hand, there are people, like there was this artist in Poland, there was, I think she was called Katarzyna Kozyra, and she was very, like very controversial artist because she was really crossing the boundaries of, in my opinion, ethics. So I remember she did that work of, it was called a pyramid of animals, something like that. So she basically, she took stuffed animals like horse, dog, cat, and a
rooster, I think.
Rooster on top of each other, and basically they were killed to be stuffed and to create this art, and there was a huge controversy around it. And my impression was that she's this artsy artist from the University of Arts. And she did something, in my opinion, very unethical and very...
It's like from the Batman, you know, this Tim Burton Batman, like Joker said he was the artist, you know?
Yeah.
First criminal artist, like murdering for art or something like that.
Yes, and I think she was... I mean, there's that area of like this quote and quote high art, which is around the universities of art, you know, like this very, very complicated art system. There is a lot of bullshit there, in my opinion, and she used that controversy to basically appear in times when there was no really social media. And yeah, so this is like another example. I think it was very short-lived. It really didn't taught me anything that art, except that there are people like her can do this kind of shit. So
actually it's kind of you know, it's interesting because we haven't really gone over what the rules are exactly, but we can say, for example, that there are technical rules, and depending on what it is you're going for, they, you know, you can follow them and you can choose not to. I mean, I think that's established. But then there are also sort of like, I guess let's just call them these marketing rules that are more about, I suppose, how you present yourself and what you should do to make sure that you're seen, you know, in like amidst so many other artists and all of the platforms that are available now. And then there's also the philosophical rules, which are more about like your personal integrity and you know, like whether you would sort of, you could say that like you, one rule, one arguable rule is you should never sacrifice your personal integrity. And another, but like another, like other people might argue that, you know, it's like, it's all about what you're willing to do to make things happen, you know? So I think that it's funny because like back in the older days, there was a wall, right? Like you, to get any sort of notice, you would either have to be extremely, you would have to have something that would draw in, like for example, established critics who would talk about your work, or you know, it was there was a very like upper tier that you had to reach, and that depended on who you rubbed elbows with, and also how good you are, or how recognizable you are maybe as an artist. But today, like, you can practically, you have more freedom to do whatever it is you want, because all of the platforms are open for you to use.
There are no middlemen.
Yeah, there are no middlemen. But the funny thing is, it's like, it also becomes, even if you're operating according to your own terms, you end up like, yeah, it's very common for people to become very like neurotic about like how often they should be posting, how they should be feeding the algorithms the right way so that they get the returns, you know, and that can really affect your personal like artistic process. So it's kind of, I guess there, like this whole idea of there being rules for art, I mean, at some point I think maybe we might need to narrow it down. Like I see it as like rules for succeeding as an artist. As an artist, rules for achieving your greatest potential as an artist, and also rules for being for truly realizing your unique artistic self, let's say.
Yeah, and I guess it's also kind of like important to really set up what we mean by saying art in general, because like what Andrew said, like there's this idea of high art, so to speak, like the official, I don't know, academic art or whatever. Yeah. Like you said, like Marco said, the acclaimed critics approved art or whatever you might call it, and there's this like popular art or pop culture in general, which involves art. Or maybe we should say craft more, like craft art or artistic craft.
Yeah,
like there's a lot of it right now. It's even called like the art industry, or more. You have like industries, like a filmmaking industry and stuff. So like industry doesn't really like come together well with art, at least in my head. It's like a different thing, really, because it's like producing stuff in a pipeline and stuff, and then there are artists involved in that, and like probably most of our listeners are kind of like a part of this world of being like being a, like a part of a pipeline of producing like artworks, or like maybe usable artworks, and not like maybe art for its own sake.
But this craft is, I think, good way to name it, because there are rules for craft, there are rules for art itself, which are more like general. But NCG is very crafty part of art. Like I just went to it. I was more and more interested, and I noticed that this is like the last part of the artistic activity where the classic. The classic craft really counts. It's also acknowledged and by the whole community. So, for example, if there was a guy on someone forums who would, you know, pout some head rendering, and basically it was like picture camera projection of some picture on some very simple base mesh, and it looked good, but all guys hated him because he would, you know, he couldn't do it the right way, and it was about craft. And all these rules of art, when you look watch YouTube videos about composition, for example, they are very often also about CG. So this is like all these attributes and all these skills which were important for guys from, let's say, Renaissance, like classic sculptors, like Raphael, and, you know, painters and stuff like that. And now you can find it in CG. Like, for example, sculpting, like ZBrush, there's a lot of classical knowledge analyzed there, and guys really are really studying this classic sculpting techniques. When I didn't study sculpture on University of Art, I'm sure there is that classic knowledge is like skill is needed, but also they go very fast to some more abstract stuff. And in CG, it's all in CG. It's like you go back to 17th century and with all the skills that artists supposed to have.
Right? Yeah, but on the other hand, like when you like move into the abstract area, in fact, you're kind of like following the same like classical principle in a way, or to some extent, because once you stop dealing with like mimicking the real world, which mm-hmm. is like a huge part of the CG industry, but there is also mm-hmm. like, you know, the stylized whole kind of world of stylized art, or like getting things like a little bit farther away from just like recreating the real world, or maybe mm-hmm. creating other worldly worlds. But you have to kind of like stick to the same principles, like proportions of elements, like complication mm-hmm. of the whole artwork, like details to the overall composition, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So keeping the balance in your artwork, and I think that an important part is like really thinking what you are really trying to do with the artwork that you're creating. And I think that there are many people who struggle because, you know, there are many images that are created with CG or whatever, which really lack one first point, that thing that these art salesmen said, this immediate mm-hmm. reaction.
Yeah.
And but it's not really about mm-hmm. craft there. Like, to some mm-hmm. extent, yeah, but this, like, craft is just a way of getting there. But really, to get there, you have to do that from the very beginning, like, really think about like the core idea mm-hmm. that you're trying to get through. But and I think that's also an important thing.
This reaction, what you said, that core reaction is actually a reaction for something that is there. And I was really thinking, what is that? Like, how to call it? Because I recently was playing around with Art Breeder, and I was like, you know, generating all these images. Okay, this is a good path. I'm going to generate this way. And at some point, I was picking the like, I had very similar variants of some landscape. And okay, this one is the best, or this one is the best. And I was thinking, okay, so what makes it really for me to think that this is the best? Because they are very similar, almost the same. And I guess so. But I was thinking, like, for me, what's driving me there? And I realized that this is mystery. Like, there's some images are too obvious and plain, and I can, you know, like, see through them. There's nothing there more. I can just see the, you know, like the wall at the end of it, see through. I understand. I just mastered that image in my head. It's all internal, like, swallowed by my mind, and there is nothing resisting there, and there's no question mark about this. Like, not even like question mark, like, what artists wanted to say, not in these terms, like question mark on terms of like, really, I mean, I don't know, having some weird situation in your life or something like that. And so it's enough vague or maybe like complicated that there is that mystery, but also, okay, so why I don't like these works which are completely abstract and shapeless, and that I had more problem to define, because I think there has to be some shape to at least lead me to some place where I get lost. So like I will have that moment when, okay, what is this image about really? Like there resembles something for me, but I can't really pinpoint it. Like what kind of emotion is that actually? And this is not like the aware dialogue in my head. This is all on the unspoken level of emotions, but I was trying to like consciously define it. So there is enough of vagueness and this works not being I don't know how to call it. I don't know the word. Like they are not closed and understandable and completely. But also there are some elements which remind me something, which kind of lead me to that trap of mystery. Like if this is completely abstract and says nothing, then I have not. I mean, it's not like even about looking for real forms. Like it's too abstract for me. I don't get it. I don't like it. No, I'm very abstract. But in this abstraction, there have to be some kind of call from that image to me that there's something that, you know, addresses something in me, and then, but it's not really at the end. Like I was talking with my friend about Hollywood movies. There are very cool Hollywood horror movies which are made fantastically, and they are all built on mystery, on you know, being afraid of something you can't see. But then at the end, this is happening very often in Hollywood movies, there has to be explanation to everything. Everything is explained. Why did this happen? This ghost had the baby, and if we do that, then it's going to be free, and this is what happened here and here, and this is the real thing. Like the mystery is solved at the end, and in the short term, it gives you some kind of good feeling, because it's like it's rewarding. Okay, we don't understand, but for me, for a longer term, it's disappointing, because I don't want to have this explained, because this is like, this is depriving me of this feeling of actually wondering what is this about, and my imagination working. So this is similar with art. Like I don't, maybe this is like women approach men. They would like to figure them out, but they don't really are disappointed when they do. Or men figuring out women, I don't know. Like there's that. You know, sometimes, you know, some people are very cool until they will say something like this, very intelligent or interesting. But if you know them too much, they're disappointing. So, yeah, but I was thinking, so I would just say that, like, so I know what turns me on in art, that mystery, but I don't know how it looks like from the point of view of artists. I don't think I really know what's that, you know, like what instrument to play and how to play them to actually have people reacting like that. In general, I don't know, maybe it's some kind of perfectionism or overanalyzing. I don't think I mean, at least aware control way, I can achieve it. But I know people around me who are not educated artistically, like a friend of mine who's drawing, and he's drawing like one drawing a year when he's not doing other stuff, and this guy can draw like a sketch, and Jesus, this guy, a man, if he went into art professionally, it would be great, but he doesn't care, and he's nailing it just like that. So I don't know, but not in terms of, okay, like envying anything, like this, you know, this that there was that movie about this composer from Amadeus, like not in these terms, but just to understand, like, what do you think? I mean, if you would like to create such a art, such a thing that actually creates this kind of impression of mystery at some point, this core point, what do you think you would do to achieve this kind of stuff?
I think that by making things that interest you, they could be the most they could be the most mundane things ever, but if you are truly able to kind of bring out your authentic self, and I know that sounds kind of, I don't know, pretentious, but if you can do that, you know, it's a very hard, because there are no clear-cut rules, right? But if you're somehow able to keep your personal integrity, you know, like who you are, I think something will shine through, and there will be something about just the combination of these little choices that you make that will make what you make very profound. I mean, there are two examples I want to, I'm sorry though, like one example I want to bring up is, I'm not sure if you guys ever heard of him, but one of my favorite like musicians is Elliot Smith. He was like he came out in the 90s, and he would write these sort of kind of country, or kind of like, you know, like it kind of like a, you know, it was alternative, but it was super, its roots were in sort of country, and you might even say, like, I don't know, Americana, you know, like his arrangements were kind of like that, and his lyrics were edgy, but so were everybody else's in the 90s, you know. And he just, like, he always used to say that, you know, like, I just play what I, you know, like I just really love like what I'm playing, and I think maybe that's what people see when I perform, or when I make songs. And really, if you look at it from a technical standpoint, like, there's nothing special about the arrangements he's done. Like, they've been done many times before. There's nothing special particularly about his singing skills. His words are great, but they're not, like, I wouldn't say they're the greatest ever. But, you know, like, he's like, just the fact that he could have made like some of his saddest songs without feeling sad at all, using like these arrangements. He didn't mean to be ironic, but he sang over his chord progressions with a very soft, close to the mic kind of voice that made everything he made sound, I don't know, like, it just sounded, it was very sort of, it wasn't something you'd be used to hearing, like you hear like Pearl Jam on the radio or Nirvana or something like that, and you listen to this guy and he gives you the exact same sort of hit, but like that's that level of like angst maybe or heaviness, but with such a gentle voice, with such conventional arrangements, like you could barely even call him rock really, but he became an icon, and I think that it's because it's because like he was being who he was, and all of his little choices, you know, all of the little choices are, oh, this is how I sing, so I'm going to sing it this way, this is how I play, I'm going to play it this way, like in of themselves they may not have been remarkable, but the combination of all of that that kind of made him, you know, that was remarkable, like the sum of parts, you know.
Yeah, I think like what Andrew mentioned about this mystery that he's like, this is driving him to react to an artwork.
Yeah, no, but that's a mystery. Listening to him, you can't really figure it out. Yeah, but
yeah,
probably he being true to himself while creating it. It was like also like asking yourself the question that you want to, kind of like if you want to draw the audience into your artwork, you have to kind of like be the audience yourself, like what I'm trying to say, like, ask yourself this question, like you need to also stay this doubtful person yourself, like the person that doesn't have all the answers in the end, like I've heard an interview with Nick Cave about that really he's kind of like experiencing this creation of art this way, like us, you know, going into venturing in some unknown lands while he's creating us. So
yeah, I guess
you have to be prepared to just like put yourself in a little bit of uncomfortable position.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's like it has to be mystery for me when I create it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And as long as it's still mysterious for me, there's a chance that it's going to be that way also for other people, I guess.
Or maybe that mystery that you see in artists is when you can tell that the artist is him or herself is searching mm-hmm. for something.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's the underlying mystery.
That search is kind of like one of the rules, I think, because we were about to discuss this rules of composition and stuff like that, and maybe we will in the next episode, but I mm-hmm. guess the important thing is once you know them, there are plenty of materials around the web, you know, about how to create a nice image, how to compose it, how to do that. But what I mean is that these rules are all like more like the pirate code in Pirates of the Caribbean. Like they're more guidelines than rules. And in fact, like creating the artwork that is going to drive you into this mystery land is kind of like when you try to cross that rule a bit, or like at least twist, or you have to be prepared to do that, because sometimes, you know, the answer to how to make this particular work outstanding is like crossing this thing that you think you know, this level of your own knowledge and being able to experiment in your own perception. I think that being open to the experiment, to the happy accidents that might come once you do something like in a non-conventional way, I mm-hmm. guess that's a good rule of thumb.
And speaking of creation, I mean, I know this is a podcast, but we'll share the links anyway, and anyone listening, I invite you to check this link out. But if I could direct your attention, gentlemen, to the Skype thread, if you could just have a look at this link. I mean, just look at the statistics on this video. It's a 3D animation, but I mean, I'd like to know what you guys make of this.
By the way, my one of my favorite animations I've seen many years ago. It's a French animation called Winter, and it's about, I don't know if you've seen it. It's about no dialogue. It's classic animation. It's about a girl whose mom is sick, and she goes with her dog on a walk during winter, and she goes back after this like very short walk, and Jesus, this is, I mean, it's a very touching movie. I will also have to find. I was looking for that movie like for months, because I once saw it and I couldn't find it. And there's a lot of short movies and animations which are called Winter. So yeah, so I will show you also that. Maybe we could talk about it in the next podcast.
Yeah. But have you seen the video I just sent?
I sign in to confirm your age. This is what I get. So I'm not signing in. I will have to watch it later.
Oh, okay.
On this computer, I cannot sign in.
Oh my goodness, that's creepy.
Right. So for you guys listening, it's A Life Well Lived by the channel Cool 3D World. I mean, god damn, like this is, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what to make of this. Like, if you're looking for mystery, then you can't go further than this, man. Like, I mean, there's clearly like a theme and there's clearly like an overarching message, but geez. Respecting the art theory of, you know, like the, well, I guess to an extent that's still true, but yeah, Andrew, you have to see this. And then I'm just wondering
if that's done, you know, on purpose, sort of.
No, yeah, look at the channel. Like all of the videos are like that. It's but it's insane. Like mm-hmm. it, you know, people are actually invested. Like, and I think that I would be too. Like, I'd want to know, you know, like what else. what else is going to come from the fascinating mind of whoever it is that makes this stuff, right? It's just
yeah, I guess you know, there are ideas, there's clearly some camera work in there, but it's yeah. definitely lacking a good, you know, good 3D artist on board, like the craftsman.
Yeah, right? And yet, I mean, just look at, like, you know, how much of an impact it's making on well, let's say the world. Like, there are 8 million views on this one video alone. And not, again, this isn't about like the popularity contest, but it just means it, you can't deny that this has given something significant to the consciousnesses of anyone who's seen this. Otherwise, you know, I don't know. It kind of throws off the whole, like, even my own beliefs or principles about what really it means to be, you know, to create, like, 3D art.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I guess that, like, the next episode has to be on the craft part of making good art this time, because the video that you showed, Marco, and I'm hoping that you guys also will be able to see that.
Please do.
That's a kind of funny experience, like talking about visual arts in general.
Yeah,
being able to show it is like, you know, dancing architecture.
Yeah, so. Exactly.
But I guess that's the podcast oddity. Hopefully you're all online and can check out the links that we provide.
Yeah, and I guess that's it.
Yeah, we're gonna have to call it.
Let's wrap it up. This was a short one, but I guess we went to, like, places, really uncharted places in the podcast.
Was very interesting to hear your opinions about that, and like thoughts. And so guys, if you would like, check the links in the description, so you can have understand the context, and maybe you will find something more interesting stuff. Like, it takes a lot of time sometimes, or luck, to find something really cool to see, and you can miss some stuff you would love for the whole life. You could miss it, like, never find some artist that you would be your favorite artist. And yeah, if you want to be creative, but not spend too much time on the technical part or waiting for your results, we at gachfarm.net, we have a revolution, because recently we doubled the number of nodes for the priorities. So this is like, on low priority, you have 100 very fast nodes for rendering your works.
I can confirm, as a regular user, like a worker of the farm, but I'm also using it for creating my, you know, things for my tutorials that I'm providing for the channel GF Academy, that we also kindly encourage you to check out. There are nice tutorials there. You want to improve your craft and skills, we offer sharing our knowledge. And I was using just recently, like, some GPU servers for rendering, like, quick previews of my animations, and it was like a breeze. You could get.
Yeah, I could say the same.
And also on the excess of nodes, we have cheaper prices, and we added V100 node servers, cards, 8 cards per server. They're very good for 3ds Max and Redshift, I think, which, by the way, we started support with cloud rendering recently, so we can render it as another engines on the cloud automatically. But also we some guys rendered Redshift on our servers before we had that cloud GPU rendering. But there are 8 cards there, which are much more powerful, and it's a very cool thing, because not all render engines support 10 cards, which we have on the older ones. So it's better sometimes to have less cards, but more powerful, because not Octane uses, I don't know, 10 cards for sure, and even more, I guess. But so yeah, so that's, and we also cut the prices. So I think this is very good stuff. And on on the cloud rendering on high priority, you have 300 nodes per job. So this is really like powerful
yeah. Power in your hands.
Yes, exactly.
As a CG artist, and I find it like quite interesting that we really made this short, like punch in announcement at the very end of the podcast. So kind of like doing the Hollywood way, like the explanation of what it's all about. It's all about making your artwork produced faster and helping you out with it. At least our service is all about that. And I'm hoping that you just follow the mystery all through this episode until that very point to hear that great, because this is all also connected with our 10th anniversary that we are celebrating.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're 10 years old.
Yeah.
We're almost teenagers. Like yeah. Next year.
It's a few more years
super,
to go.
Super curious about the whole world.
Puberty, here we come. Yeah. Well, anyway, so thanks for hanging out with us again. And I guess we'll see you in the next one.
Yeah.
Yeah, see you around.
See you later, guys.
Or hear you around.